Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm Reverend Cindy Carr, Senior Minister at First Congregational Church, Watertown United Church of Christ. We are a congregation that welcomes people of diverse backgrounds, orientations, and faith experiences. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome with us here at First Church. We continue to worship online in order to keep everyone safe. This week, Governor Lamont lifted some restrictions on places of worship. In response to that, our COVID-19 team met to discuss what this might mean here at First Congregational Church. Because of limited space in the sanctuary, the high rates of infection, and the introduction of at least three very contagious variants of the COVID-19 virus, we will remain online for worship for the time being. We very much miss seeing all our friends and fellow Christians for worship, for social hour and more, but it's just not safe right now. We will get there, but one of the most important things we do, if we care about each other, is to be sure we don't cause any harm or risk. And we're committed to our church being safe in all the ways that matter. We encourage you to get your vaccines and continue the three W's of this pandemic life. Wear a mask, wash your hands, and watch your distance. Working together, we can help stem the tide of the pandemic and get back to life. Until then, I encourage you to stay connected with us. You can visit our website and Facebook pages, which are listed below, and you can sign up to receive our weekly email blasts and our monthly newsletter. And if you're watching on Facebook, I encourage you to hit the like button and let us know that you're with us. Today is the last in a three-part series on discipleship and what our mission is as the Christian church. We'll hear again from Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, where he talks about the importance of service and how that shapes the mission and effectiveness of the local church. But let's join together now in prayer as we begin this time of worship. Loving God, we bask in the healing power of your love. You are always with us. You are with us when we cry out in fear. You are with us when we are discouraged. You are with us when we feel alone. You are with us all the time, day and night. For your presence, we are most thankful, and we lift up our hearts to you now. In Jesus' name, amen. Enter into a time of prayer, I ask that you keep these following prayers in your hearts and remember to lift up to God all the things that are on your mind and weighing on your shoulders. I would ask for your prayers for our nation as we continue dealing with the pandemic and the loss of lives, for our government and elected leaders, especially those who this week will be navigating another impeachment trial. Please pray for our local leaders who are navigating school and hospitals and businesses at this difficult time. I'd also ask you to pray for healthcare workers, military service personnel, and all those trying to keep us safe and healthy. And pray for those who struggle to find and get their vaccines and the agencies and administrators dealing with supply issues. I would also encourage you to pray for those affected by the increased anxiety, depression, and isolation caused by this pandemic. Let's be together in prayer. Gracious Lord, you have given us life and brought us into being by your breath. You have loved and nurtured and cared for us in ways that we may never know, but often take for granted. Sometimes we try to act as if we do not depend on you. Something within us makes us want to appear as if we are all powerful and are independent of you if we only wish. And when we do push ourselves away from you and feel the awfulness of that separation, we become less than we are meant to be. Lord, help us to admit that we do need you and that being dependent upon you is not a sign of weakness, but of strength. For it is only when we see who we truly are and how we are truly related to you that we can become strong, not of our own accord, but because we then draw our strength from you. Today, as we contemplate Paul's words to the Corinthian church, help us to discern ways in which we may serve your people. Help us let go of our own demands and focus instead on humbling ourselves before you so that we might do your will and not our own. We pray that you will give us strength to grow in our ministry of outreach in this community and in our world. Your love needs to be shared and received more so now than at any other time. We pray for these and all things in the name of Jesus Christ, who teaches us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We serve in many ways, in many areas of our lives. As a local congregation, we seek to serve those with various levels of needs in the church and in the community. We plan ahead for ways to reach out and depend on our members and friends to support the budget that allows ministry to happen. We are so grateful for all that you give, financially, materially, and spiritually. Let's take a moment now to give thanks to God for all these offerings. Loving God, we rejoice that we are able to love because you first loved us. May the gifts we give be used by your church as agents of your love, compassion, and justice, that we might provide for our neighbors' needs with more than bread alone. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading for today comes from Paul's first letter to the church at Corinth, chapter 9, verses 16 through 23. Paul continues in this letter to the church at Corinth by addressing the notion of serving others. He starts off by talking about his right to be paid for his work and notes that while he gives it up by choice, the church should not expect this. We do well to remember he has an occupation as a tent maker and has generous patrons that fund his ministry. But the main point of this passage is the way in which Paul models how we are to reach out to others in humility, to share the gospel, and to care for those in need. Hear these words. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a servant to all, so that I might win more people. To the Jews I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. May God's wisdom be added to our hearing and understanding of these holy words. Thank you. mom was an educator. Back in the day, she put herself through college and became a teacher at the Melissa Jones Elementary School in Guilford, Connecticut. She loved to teach. Mom used to have a saying, there are three professions that you must have a call to do, otherwise you have no business doing them. Ministry, medicine, and teaching. Mom was dedicated to her call. She spent countless hours after school giving extra help. When I was a teen, there were many evenings I couldn't gab on the phone with my friends because mom was on the phone with parents, touching base with them to make sure that homework got done and the kids kept reading. And it paid off. Her students thrived. I was always struck at how her former students and their parents would stop her in the grocery store just to say hi to Mrs. Carr. They loved her. There was a point at which mom was asked to consider becoming principal of the school. She had fought hard for increasing teachers' salaries and to have their voice heard by the administration. She was well respected and qualified, but she turned down the job offer. When I asked her why, she said, "It's not what I'm here for. I belong in the classroom. The kids need me there, not in the administration. I came into this profession to teach, to serve the kids and their families, and that's what I'm going to do." This left such an impression on me. Life isn't always about a climb up the ladder. Sometimes it's about using your gifts where they are needed the most, and she knew she was there to serve. I've been struck over the years in ministry at meeting so many other people like my mom. Quiet heroes who keep their focus on the people they feel called to serve, whether that's in the classroom or on the hospital floor or in a cafeteria or in the boardroom. I think my mom was right that ministry, medicine, and education each require a call, but I think there are many other ways in which we are called to serve as well. In our scripture passage today, Paul continues his conversation with the church at Corinth. By his own admission, Paul was a free man of considerable affluence in his society. He had the benefit of a good education. He was a gifted orator and debater. And while he was not affluent, he was hardly poor. In his day, there was a rigid class system in place, and the expectation was that he would associate only with those of his own kind, not with those considered beneath him. But Paul broke ranks from his peers and made sure that he associated with and was compassionate towards those who were not at his station in life. He wrote that he made himself as one to all he could so that he could share the good news with them. He was especially cognizant of those he described as weak, meaning a person without the power or means to rise above poverty, illness, homelessness, or hunger. Paul urged the church at Corinth to do the same, to keep in mind that we are called to serve, not to be served. Paul preached that the word of God and salvation in Christ are available to all, regardless of their place in society. In Christ, no one is above or below another, but all are necessary to the body of Christ. God loves all who know him through Jesus. Now, this can be a challenge for us in the modern church. So much of the Christian church is set up in a kind of hierarchical system, with the masses at the very bottom and the royalty at the top. Authority and power have been historically denied in the church on the basis of gender, race, ethnicity, orientation, and so much more. The church simply reflects our human tendency to separate and organize people into classes, with only those deemed worthy at the top empowered to make decisions. If we read Paul closely, this goes against what Jesus calls us to do. We are to become as one, or to put ourselves in another's shoes the best we can, to reach out to those dealing with adversity. We are to serve. It's imperative that modern congregations understand this call to serve and live it daily. We are to be the light, the hope, the example of God's love in all we do. There are several things we can keep in mind as we aspire to fully embrace this biblical vision of servanthood. First, we put function over form. Function over form. What does this mean? Well, many of us have a great devotion to the church buildings and spaces that have provided comfort, fellowship, marked rites of passage in our lives, and provided inspiration for us. Indeed, we have been gifted by our ancestors in the faith with this beautiful sanctuary. It's filled with symbols of the faith and signs of our history. And we have so many talented volunteers who do incredible work to keep our buildings safe and beautiful. But our buildings are not our faith. They are to be used to inspire and deepen our faith. We come here to worship God, but we do not worship the buildings. In times like this, when we cannot safely gather here, we are still the church and still the people of God, still called to serve. A church that worships at picnic tables after a tornado, or in a tent, or in the basement of another congregation because they can't afford their own building, is just as much a church as those in grander spaces. The function or mission of the church is to create disciples and share the good news. The form, or the physical plant in which we worship, while it is amazing, is not what defines us. We are not more important or more worthy if we worship in a grand cathedral than those who worship in a storefront. Some years ago, I served a church that had a building and a sanctuary that were incredibly beautiful, but the church council meetings could get ugly. There was a strong desire to protect the building from outsiders that they imagined might not cherish the building in the same way they did. So they turned away AA groups. They refused collection bins for used clothing and non-perishables, and denied use of the kitchen to outside groups. This wasn't a matter of creating and administering sensible policies to hold others accountable. Every church needs to do that. Rather, things were said like, we shouldn't allow drunks in here, and we can't have piles of clothing and toys and cans of food accumulating in our beautiful hall. It'll send the wrong message. Well, I'm pretty sure that Paul and Jesus would see that stuff being collected and distributed to those in need as signs of God's kingdom rather than a threat to a high-class appearance. I'm pretty sure that the higher the stack of canned goods, the bigger the stack of Christmas gifts, the bigger the piles of donated clothing, the bigger the heart of the church, and the more that community has grasped the notion of what it means to serve. Secondly, we include all God's people in the circle of fellowship, especially those who might make us feel uncomfortable. The fellowship we share with our faith community is a gift from God. We are required to share it, and not just with our own friends, but with strangers, with those who may look different, love differently, live differently, and think differently than we do. This sounds easy, but it's not always the case. One time, a young man came into worship after we had already started the first hymn. I could see him from the pulpit, but most of the congregation could not. He was known by some there, but was away often from church for long periods of time as he struggled with mental illness. There were times he heard voices. Sometimes he would stand up in church to give testimony without being asked. Sometimes his name appeared in the paper for disturbing the peace. But what I saw happen that day was amazing. The deacons at the back of the church, who knew this young man from the time he was little and knew his mom, approached him respectfully, offered him a bulletin, and showed him to a seat. Clearly, he made some people uncomfortable, and a few even said to me that I should do something about him. But the deacons were clear and defiant. They believed that all of God's people should have a seat waiting for them in church, and this young man was no exception. This is the way that faith reaches out in love and in service to all. Thirdly, we walk alongside people, not ahead of them. This is what Paul was getting at when he said he tried to become like others. Even with his status in the community, he tried to put himself in other people's shoes. I had a conversation with a friend of mine who works in a restaurant. And the topic came up about things that bug waiters and food service workers the most. The first is when people don't give a fair tip for the service given. Waitstaff are not paid regular wages. They depend on those tips. The second is when people make them run back and forth and back and forth when they could have thought a little bit ahead of time and just asked for what they needed all at once. Not that a packet of Splenda or an extra spoon is a problem, but there are those who feel they have the right to make their waiters keep moving for them. After all, it's their job, they say. If they would literally put themselves in their waiter's shoes or try on their very tired feet, their behavior would be different. And the third thing mentioned was the mess that some people make at the table. And it's not just teens, adults do this too. There's a real person who has to clean up the mess that you make. They are there to serve you, yes, but it can get downright disgusting. It's disrespectful. If you don't behave that way when your mom serves a meal, then why would you do it to a stranger? Now, I've never waited on tables. I've done other service jobs, but I haven't had to deal with lousy tips, running around for someone else's entertainment, and I've never had to clean up a Jackson Pollock painting made from ketchup at table 5. But I don't have to be a waiter to see it's important that we try to understand what others go through, to get a glimpse of life from the other side of the menu, so to speak. Did you know that in the early church, deacons waited on tables? The Greek word diakonos appears 29 times in the New Testament. It literally means one who waits on tables. Deacons were waiters or servers for table fellowship, assisting in serving the bread and wine at communion, and assisting in the distribution of food and clothing to those in need. They were required to adopt an attitude of service in Christ's name. Paul calls all of us who are baptized into Christ to adopt an attitude of service to others as well. Putting ourselves in another's shoes, asking what someone else needs, asking, "How can I help?" are all part of this way of being together. Taking an attitude of service strengthens the mission of the church and breaks down the barriers between us. Writer Eric Barreto puts it this way: our strength is neither earned by ourselves or for our own sake. Instead, real strength is drawing alongside the weak and walking with them. As we continue into the year 2021, we will continue to ponder the mission of the church and indeed our own call into discipleship. We learn at the feet of the teacher, Jesus. We reach out to others in agape love, and we serve in the name of Jesus Christ. I'll close with these words once again from the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who said this: life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others? May God bless us as we contemplate the answer together. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we conclude this time of worship together, receive this blessing. May the God of all hope open our eyes, May the God of all peace still our anxious minds. May the God of all love fill our hearts to fullness beyond measure. Let us go now in the hope and peace and love of God. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us. Amen.